Hey, what's up dudes and dudettes? Big Jake here, and welcome back. Today, I have another video for you that's going to give you some tips and tricks on making synthwave music in GarageBand. We're going to be looking at some of the synth parameters I use in making my songs, specifically kind of the bass layer to all that. We're going to be looking at some drums, some bass synth, and some pads that I use. So let's get going. All right, shameless plug here. If you haven't watched my first video on making synthwave in GarageBand for iPhone, I would start there. In that video, I kind of give you some tips on crafting your overall sound, and that would be super helpful to know before you start digging into individual synths. So go check that out first if you haven't yet. If you already have, you'll know that reverb and delay are actually super important in crafting your overall sound. So I'll kind of show you some of those reverb settings along with the synth parameters for each of these as we go along. I figured we would start out with some synth bass. Because when I'm writing a song, 9 times out of 10, I start by writing the bass line. So I found that the retro bass preset that comes with GarageBand is a good starting point for a lot of synthwave songs. And this first bass that we're going to look at here is a little bit more mellow, a little bit more laid back compared to a lot of my other basses. And there's the parameters. Pause the video if you need to look at these more in depth. We're gonna keep moving. This is what its reverb settings look like down there. And I tend not to pan the bass. I usually like to keep it pretty centered, but you can play around with that and see what sounds good in your song. This is what it sounds like here. Yeah, like I was saying, that one's pretty chill. I tend to like to use it in intros of songs or quieter sections of songs. Staying with the retro bass, here's some more parameters for another bass that I use. It has a little bit more grit to it than the first bass. Over to the track controls, there's your reverb, there's your echo. Now here's how that bass sounds on its own. The next bass we're going to look at actually comes from the Alchemy synth in GarageBand. And if you haven't checked that out before, you really should. There are a lot of great tones you can craft out of the Alchemy synth. It has a lot more freedom than the other built-in synths. So I use on this one the modern 80s bass preset. Here's the specific parameters. Kind of halfway between the bright and muted, you can see there. And we'll show you the other knobs there. That's what it looks like. Now this one is the heaviest out of all of the basses we've seen so far. I use a little less reverb on this one than the others. And this is how it sounds on its own. Now, I very rarely use a bass by itself. I like to layer them. I like to combine them. It can give you a more interesting tone. It can give you a little more control in what parts of the tone you want to come out. You're also able to do some automations and merge tracks, and I can show you how to do that in another video. But combining that with multiple basses going at the same time, you can just get some really cool sounds that you couldn't get from one bass on its own. I'll show you what I mean here. We'll start with just the modern 80s bass that we just looked at, and then I'll show you that combined with the second retro bass we did. On its own, it's all right. Gives it a little more definition there. maybe for a quieter section of the song, you could use the two retro bass parameters we looked at there. As opposed to just the first bass on its own. So yeah, you can have a lot of fun there. If you find a few bass sounds you like, finding out how to combine those, especially when you mess with different velocities between those, and there's really just endless possibilities for your sound. But those are just a few of the basses that I use there. Let's also look at drums. Those are super important, as you know, I'm sure. I tend to use the sequential drum tracks. And unfortunately, in GarageBand on the iPhone, you don't have a ton of control over the drums. You can still control the velocity input, which will do a lot. You can control, you know, reverbs, delays, things like that. But as for the drums themselves, you get what you get pretty much. I'll show you some track controls. And because of kind of the limitations there, I'll generally use multiple drum tracks. I might want one centered, and here's a look at another one. See that one, I panned a little bit to give you a little bit of a different sound there. That one has a ton of reverb. That one has a little less reverb on it. So here's kind of what that drum sounds like. Now, I find the key to the drums is the editor, and I use this for any synth that I'm writing music for. You just click on the track section there, and you hit edit. Brings up this screen, and you can make the things that you wrote more precise. You can fine-tune them. It's just a nice little way to write music there. And something else you can use to make your drums more interesting are multiple layers of reverb or multiple layers of echo. And I'll show you how to do that here. If you watched my first video, I showed you how to enable AU plugins, which you're gonna need to do before you do this. Down here, you have your echo and your reverb, of course, and you can go in and tailor those to what you want. But let's say you wanted multiple delays on one track. You can't do that with only the built-in delay. But you go into your plugins and EQ, you hit edit, you add another plugin, go over to your AU extensions after you have those enabled, and you can go down to the AU delay. And that'll give you a second delay you can play with and double up on your delays there. I'll also be showing you one of the pads that I like to use quite a bit. Some of the built-in pad presets actually aren't too bad. Some of them don't need a lot of tweaking, so you might want to look through those as well, see if you can find one you like. But another pad I like to use comes from the Spectrum Echo preset. Here are some of the parameters I use within that preset, and I find that pads are super helpful for just filling in your sound, kind of making everything meld together a little bit better. We'll take a look at the track controls here. I do like to pan these usually, and I usually have multiple pads going on. There's your echo, a lot of reverb on it. It can be tempting when you're writing pads to just make these super expansive pads because it's gonna sound good on its own. You might want to naturally be inclined to write pads that span multiple octaves. That's okay in some instances, but it can also muddy up your sound. So I find that just setting a pad for not quite as much space as you might normally want to use can actually help your overall tone in the end. And the only way to know that is to play with, you know, different octaves on the pad. Now, Now, I might choose to add another octave to that after the fact. So you can duplicate a track there. We'll just copy and paste that same exact note region in. And if you go to settings, it's a really easy way to change octaves. You got octaves plus or minus if you want. So let's go one octave below and see how that sounds together. Now we'll also pan it a little bit to the other side. Altogether, that'll lay down a pretty good starting point for your whole song. This is what it would sound like. And from there, it's all about figuring out how you want to build the song, figuring out different sections for the song, figuring out leads, and things like that. But as long as you have a good starting point, the rest of it will come together pretty easy. Hey, I hope this video was helpful for you guys. And if you have any questions, just leave them in the comments down below, and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. If you would, leave a like, subscribe to the channel. That would be a huge help to me. And until next time, my dudes, stay classy.